Now, I'm also saying that that's years and years away, and there's exits all along, and all it's going to take is one sensible adult in the room to take some of these exits. Now, the question is, do we have them? I thought Jay Powell was the guy. He seems reasonable. He seems solid. But the fact that he continues to buy $40 billion a month of mortgage-backed bonds into a housing market that any logical person would tell you is on fire, to me, makes me question his competence.
What are some of the exits along the way?
Stop printing money.
Okay.
Stop keeping rates inorganically low. You can make an argument that rates have been kept inorganically low since the mid to early 80s. So rates should be where borrower meets lender. When the Fed gets involved in that, it does two things. It lowers rates and it increases malinvestment or walking out the risk curve, which people wouldn't have done. But it also affects just the messaging from certain rates, like the repo market. The Fed involved in the repo market and they want to have a standing repo facility. But financial markets look to the repo market as an indication of the health and of certain borrowers and lenders within that structure. Now, if the Fed comes in and stands there and just they're the central clearinghouse of repo, and by the way, I don't think anyone has to understand what repo even is to understand what I'm saying here, is that the Fed is involved in this transaction now, and no longer do we receive the messages from that rate. Does that make sense?
Yes.
Like what they've done with the yield curve.
Got
right.
It.
Like with the yield curve. It used to be when the yield curve flattened and inverted, we could believe that there was an imminent recession. It was an excellent predictor. Now the Fed is actively manipulating long-end rates. Well, that takes away some of the predictive power. So all of a sudden, you can think things are fine when they're not, or think things are bad when they're not.
So these are the exit strategies that the Fed can take
Get
along
the
way,
way. Yeah.
To prevent the cataclysmic currency collapse, I
That's,
believe you called
it, good,
the
isn't
triple
it?
C.
It's fun, isn't it?
Maybe fun to say,
say
will not
to
be
say,
fun
right.
to live through.
No, those are when those things happen, those are the worst kind of crises. You know what I mean? When you see that in Caracas, Venezuela, you know, the feral cat and rat population went down because that becomes a food
yes.
source when currencies
yes.
collapse. And again, I'm not saying that's going to happen. I'm saying we're being a little cavalier.
Okay, but you do not believe that we're headed towards that level of crisis?
We're pointed at it, but I don't believe we're going to get there.
Okay, hopefully.
But I'm going to be prepared a little bit.
And that preparation entails what?
Well, as we said, that my dollar portfolio, which is the gold, platinum, silver,
okay.
Real estate, I think, you know, I can't stress that enough. Not just paper real estate, but actual real estate.
What is your position on the equity market, given that we've established that we could be on the way to this doomsday scenario, though it'll take some time, and inflation is proving to be a lot stickier than anticipated?
Okay, stocks don't mind inflation. Stocks don't like stagflation. They don't mind some inflation. I actually am still somewhat bullish on the stock market. Everybody, we talked today here about potential bubbles. I think we're in a stage of bubble creation, but I think we're in an early stage. I think that everything that I look at is up 30%, up 40% since pre-pandemic levels. And I'm talking about lumber, cotton, natural gas. Why shouldn't the stocks be up too? They're just another thing that's denominated in dollars. The reality of it is just the dollar is 25% lower than it was. So some of the stock market gain, and I know that multiples are not very attractive, but multiples have stayed not very attractive for long periods of time. So I'm still okay with the stock market.
Are there any particular sectors that you're particularly bullish on with the stock market?
I am, and it's the Russell 2000 is what I'm beginning to look at more now, and I'm planning some positioning. I like, as a technical trader, I see the Russell's been in a relatively tight range for about the last few months. As it starts to move higher, I plan on buying it. Now, the fundamental reason I'm going to say is that, you know, the NASDAQ outperformed aggressively since the March 23rd of 2020 lows. When we bounced off those lows, the NASDAQ had rates were going to zero or thereabouts. Tech stocks love that. The growth portfolio loves low rates because they're valued by every Wall Street analyst on this discounted cash flow model. So if rates start to go higher, which they could now, the NASDAQ could be hurt. Plus also they were the work from home stocks, the digital age, the information out being in person, and they benefited from that greatly. Now I think that's going to reverse. And I think, so the argument I make for Russell is less good than the argument I make against the NASDAQ. I'm not sure the technicals are saying that the Russell is, and perhaps the fundamental story is that's going to be more of a domestic growth story.
Why would the Russell, which is predominantly made of smaller cap stocks, perform well when we could be in a stagflationary environment, when the IMF, for example, cutting the US growth forecast by 1% and inflation is proving to be sticky while growth forecasts are not as robust, why would that support your case that the Russell 2000 could be poised to benefit?
It certainly doesn't, the way you put it, by the way. But what does support the case is that the government still continues its spending, still continues injecting money into the system. The Fed perhaps begins to get out of the way, although I don't believe that the Fed will get out of the way as quickly as some people think, and I think the Fed will keep rates low. So any argument you can give that's negative for stocks in general, for the last, not even just the last 2 years, perhaps the last 5, 6, 7 years, you can make the counter argument that anything bad is coupled with more excess spending, more lower rates, dovish Fed, that counterbalances the negative. So I think that...
So you don't see the Fed tapering?
No, I mean, the Atlanta Fed just lowered their GDP estimates from 6% to 0.5%. I don't know exactly which quarter they're talking about, again, but I don't care. The point is that things are changing quickly, as you said. So the Fed tapering in that kind of environment seems kind of silly to me. Should they? I mean, they absolutely should taper. I said before they should get out of the way. I guess the odds of the Fed tapering is what I'm going to say have lessened.
All right, let's circle back to silver, because as you said, that is sort of your prime pick at the moment.
At the moment.
And you said that some of the interest in silver has been taken away, and in gold has been taken away by Bitcoin, which has now reached an all-time high.
Mm-hmm.
The trend that is of Bitcoin taking away interest from silver, just to clarify.
So I'm going to say that's a yes. You know, this week is the week of a launch of a Bitcoin ETF. All along the way, every different level of institutional adoption validates cryptocurrencies. El Salvador, not an economically significant country, but a real live country, adopting that as a currency. It's an amazing thing. I thought the biggest instance is when the CME launched their Bitcoin futures in 2017, kind of legitimized Bitcoin. I don't know if they intended to do that. Actually, I did meet with the Futures Trade Commission on that too. And they're like, no, just people want to trade Bitcoin and you know, we don't want to stop them. So they didn't really have an opinion on it. But I think allowing that contract to happen has given some legitimacy to crypto. Again, I'm in crypto. I don't try to trade it and time it. I'm keeping it as a dollar hedge in case of the cataclysmic event we're talking about. And I don't want to be without proper dollar hedges. I'm not sure that's the right one, but it belongs in the portfolio, I think.
Okay, so 12-month outlook for silver, you said $35.
Sure.
What's your 5 and 10-year outlook for silver?
I'm a trader. I don't even necessarily do 5 and 10-year. So I'm going to say no to that. Is that okay? I like my different portfolios that I trade are, you know, 2 week, 3 month, 6 month, a year. I will give it. I do think once this ball starts rolling, it could roll for a long time.